Thank you for listening to our audiobooks. We do our best to regularly upload quality books with clear narrations. Please subscribe to our channel and click the notification bell icon so we can bring you more great books. Thank you very much and enjoy your audiobook.
I was relieved to see that this was one of the former type. His charge at Andy and his subsequent struggles had made him breathless. And as he gulped deeply at the anaesthetic, his eyes glazed and he began to sway. He took a few stumbling steps, toppled onto his side, and slipped into unconsciousness. Now I had to move fast. I struggled through the straw, grabbed the guillotine, and dropped the cutting jaws over a horn. I seized the shafts and began to pull. With small animals, a single swift clip did the job. But the horns of these big bullocks were extraordinarily wide at the base, and I had to haul away with all my strength for several panting seconds till the knives crunched together. I repeated the process with the other horn, and it was just as tough to remove. "Right!" I gasped. "Get the muzzle off him!" I was sweating, and I had done only one beast, with about 19 to go. The brothers leapt into action, unbuckling the muzzle and running to usher another bullock from the pen, where their father was already screaming and flailing around him with his stick. With the loss of a little more perspiration, I did the second and third, but the fourth defeated me. The horns were so vast that I had to open the shafts wider and wider until they were almost in a straight line. I groaned and strained, but it was obvious I would never be able to close them. Thomas, who had the build of a heavyweight wrestler, came up behind me.
"Move in a bit closer, Mr. Herriot," he said.
I grasped the shafts halfway up their length while Thomas seized the extreme ends in his great hands. Even with our united effort, nothing happened for a few seconds. Then the horn came off with a crack. But unfortunately, I was the man in the middle, and as the shafts came together, they thudded with pitiless force against my ribs. It was the same with the other horn. Thomas had to help again, and my ribs took another hammering. As the brothers trotted off for the next beast, I sank down on the straw and moaned softly as I massaged my aching sides. "Are you all right, Jim?" The voice came from above, and I looked up into Andy's anxious face. I had been vaguely aware of him all the time, rocking on his chains as he twisted around in the rack to see as much as possible.
I gave him a rueful smile. "Oh, yes, Andy, I'm okay. Just a bit bruised."
"I don't doubt it. I wouldn't like that big bloke squeezing me in those choppers." My friend's head protruding from the hay was all I could see of him, but his eyes looked startled. They looked still more startled when the next beast, at the first sniff of chloroform, launched himself forward and knocked me flat on my back. In fact, it was clear that little Mr. Dunning was upsetting the cattle by his constant shrieking and the poking with his stick. Thomas thought so too.
"For God's sake, Dad," he said in his slow way, "put that bloody stick away and shut up."
He spoke without anger, because he was fond of his father, as indeed I was, because he was a nice little man at heart. Mr. Dunning quietened down, but he could contain himself for only a brief spell. Very soon, he was yelling again. About halfway through, the dreaded accident happened. I chopped through the tourniquet on one of the horns.
"Quick, more twine!"
I shouted, groping my way through the red fountain spurting high from the sleeping animal. I had to retie the tourniquet with the warm fluid spraying my face. There was no escape. As I pulled the last knot tight, I turned to Mr. Dunning. "Could I have a bucket of warm water, some soap and a towel, please?" My eyes were almost closed, the lashes gummed with the fast clotting blood. The little man hurried to the house and was back soon with a steaming bucket into which I eagerly plunged my hands. A second later, I was hopping around the fold yard, yelping with pain and shaking my scalded fingers.
"This bloody water's boiling hot!" I cried.
The brothers regarded me stolidly, but little Mr. Dunning was highly amused. His high-pitched giggles went on and on. He hadn't seen anything so funny for a long time. While he was recovering, William fetched some cold water and diluted the original sufficiently for me to give my hands and face a rough wash. I went on with my work almost automatically, and with increasing weariness. The driving of each bullock into the box, the bangings and oaths from behind the door, the final yell of,
"He's coming out!"
Then the straining and the chopping, and all the time in the back of my mind the question which every veterinary surgeon of that era must have asked himself. Why in heaven's name did I have to study 5 years at college just to do this? But at last I saw with relief that there was only one more to do. I had just about had enough. Thomas had done his nutcracker act on my ribs a few times more, and every muscle in my body seemed to be protesting. I watched, thankfully, as Mr. Dunning started to drive the beast into the yard. This animal, however, was reacting differently to the little man's bawling and stickwork. I remembered that the brothers had described the beast as being bully-headed, and indeed there was a vibrant masculinity about its shape and expression, which suggested that the bloodless castrators might not have done their work completely. The shaggy head, instead of turning away from Mr. Dunning's importunities, kept pushing towards him. The little farmer poked at the nose with his stick, but it still came on, and at that point Mr. Dunning evidently decided he would be better out of the way. He walked off through the straw, and the bullock walked after him. He broke into a trot, and the bullock did the same. The trot became a stiff-legged gallop, and the bullock followed suit. At no time did the beast show any sign of charging the farmer, but Mr. Dunning didn't seem reassured. He kept on running, and his face registered increasing alarm. His progress was impeded by the deep straw, and it must have been like running in knee-high water. But for all that, he cut out a very fair pace for a 60-year-old. Nobody interfered. Maybe we were all a bit irritated by his antics during the afternoon, but we stood back and laughed. I laughed so much that it hurt my bruised ribs as Mr. Dunning shot down one side of the row of tumblers, then up the other, with the big animal's nose a foot behind his neck. It might have been a Roman arena, with the mocking spectators and Andy way above, rocking perilously in his cradle as he watched the chase. It had to end sometime. After the second circuit, Mr. Dunning's cap flew off. He made a few lunging strides, then fell flat on his face in the straw. The animal did nothing more than run over the top of him, then allowed itself to be caught as though the whole thing had been a tease. The little farmer jumped to his feet, hurt only in his dignity, and glared at us as he retrieved his cap. With the help of the brothers, I dehorned the beast and the afternoon's work was over. We helped Andy down from the rack, and it took quite a while to brush the hayseeds from his smart surge. He watched impassively as I cleaned and dried my guillotine, and with an effort heaved it into the boot. Then, with my own little brush, I washed the thick plastering of muck from my Wellingtons before putting on my shoes. We got into the car and drove away into the darkening countryside. Andy lit another cigarette, and I could see him glancing at my sweaty, blood-flecked face, and at my hand feeling the tenderness of my ribs under my jacket. "Jim," he said at length, "it's funny how you can jump to conclusions. Maybe my own job isn't so bad after all." Chapter 34. In the semi-darkness of the surgery passage, I thought it was a hideous growth dangling from the side of the dog's face, but as he came closer, I saw that it was only a condensed milk can. Not that condensed milk cans are commonly found sprouting from dogs' cheeks, but I was relieved because I knew I was dealing with brandy again. I hoisted him onto the table. "Brandy, you've been in the dustbin again." The big golden Labrador gave me an apologetic grin and did his best to lick my face. He couldn't manage it since his tongue was jammed inside the can, but he made up for it by a furious wagging of tail and rear end. "Oh, Mr. Herriot, I am sorry to trouble you again." Mrs. Westby, his attractive young mistress, smiled ruefully. "He just won't keep out of that dustbin. Sometimes the children and I get the cans off ourselves, but this one is stuck fast. His tongue is trapped under the lid." "Yes. Yes," I eased my finger along the jagged edge of the metal. "It's a bit tricky, isn't it? We don't want to cut his mouth." As I reached for a pair of forceps, I thought of the many other occasions when I had done something like this for Brandy. He was one of my patients, a huge, lolloping, slightly goofy animal, but this dustbin raiding was becoming an obsession. He liked to fish out a can and lick out the tasty remnants, but his licking was carried out with such sudden dedication that he burrowed deeper and deeper until he got stuck. Again and again he had been freed by his family or myself from fruit salad cans, corned beef cans, baked bean cans, soup cans. There didn't seem to be any kind of can he didn't like. I gripped the edge of the lid with my forceps and gently bent it back along its length. till I was able to lift it away from the tongue. An instant later, that tongue was slobbering all over my cheek as Brandy expressed his delight and thanks.
"Get back, you daft dog,"
I said, laughing as I held the panting face away from me.
"Yes, come down, Brandy."
Mrs. Westby hauled him from the table and spoke sharply.
"It's all very fine making a fuss now, but you're becoming a nuisance with this business. It will have to stop."
The scolding had no effect on the lashing tail, and I saw that his mistress was smiling. You just couldn't help liking Brandy because he was a great ball of affection and tolerance without an ounce of malice in him. I had seen the Westby children. There were three girls and a boy, carrying him around by the legs, upside down, or pushing him in a pram, sometimes dressed in baby clothes. Those youngsters played all sorts of games with him, but he suffered them all with good humour. In fact, I'm sure he enjoyed them. Brandy had other idiosyncrasies, apart from his fondness for dustbins. I was attending the Westby cat at their home one afternoon when I noticed the dog acting strangely. Mrs. Westby was sitting knitting in an armchair while the oldest girl squatted on the hearthrug with me and held the cat's head. It was when I was searching my pockets for my thermometer that I noticed Brandy slinking into the room. He wore a furtive air as he moved across the carpet and sat down with studied carelessness in front of his mistress. After a few moments, he began to work his rear end gradually up the front of the chair towards her knees. Absently, she took a hand away from her knitting and pushed him down, but he immediately restarted his backward ascent. It was an extraordinary mode of progression, his hips moving in a very slow rumba rhythm as he elevated them inch by inch, and all the time the golden face was blank and innocent, as though nothing at all was happening. Fascinated, I stopped hunting for my thermometer and watched. Mrs. Westby was absorbed in an intricate part of her knitting and didn't seem to notice that Brandy's bottom was now firmly parked on her shapely knees, which were clad in blue jeans. The dog paused as though acknowledging that phase one had been successfully completed. Then, ever so gently, he began to consolidate his position, pushing his way up the front of the chair with his forelimbs, till at one time he was almost standing on his head. It was at that moment, just when one final backward heave would have seen the great dog ensconced on her lap, that Mrs. Westby finished the tricky bit of knitting and looked up.
"Oh, really, Brandy, you are silly."
She put her hand on his rump and sent him slithering disconsolately to the carpet, where he lay and looked at her with liquid eyes. "What was all that about?" I asked. Mrs. Westby laughed.
"Oh, it's these old blue jeans. When Brandy first came here as a tiny puppy, I spent hours nursing him on my knee, and I used to wear the jeans a lot then. Ever since, even though he's a grown dog, the very sight of the things make him try to get on my knee."
"But he doesn't just jump up."
"Oh, no," she said. "He's tried it and got ticked off. He knows perfectly well I can't have a Hughes Labrador in my lap."
"So now it's the stealthy approach, eh?" She giggled.
"That's right. When I'm preoccupied, knitting or reading, sometimes he manages to get nearly all the way up. And if he's been playing in the mud, he makes an awful mess and I have to go and change. That's when he really does receive a scolding."
A patient like Brandy added colour to my daily round. When I was walking my own dog, I often saw him playing in the fields by the river. One particularly hot day, many of the dogs were taking to the water either to chase sticks or just to cool off. But whereas they glided in and swam off sedately, Brandy's approach was unique. I watched as he ran up to the river bank, expecting him to pause before entering. But instead, he launched himself outwards, legs splayed in a sort of swallow dive, and hung for a moment in the air rather like a flying fox before splashing thunderously into the depth. To me, it was the action of a completely happy extrovert. On the following day, in those same fields, I witnessed something even more extraordinary. There is a little children's playground in one corner. A few swings, a roundabout, and a slide. Brandy was disporting himself on the slide. For this activity, he had assumed an uncharacteristic gravity of expression and stood calmly in the queue of children. When his turn came, he mounted the steps, slid down the metal slope, all dignity and importance, then took a staid walk round to rejoin the queue. The little boys and girls who were his companions seemed to take him for granted. But I found it difficult to tear myself away. I could have watched him all day. I often smiled to myself when I thought of Brandy's antics. But I didn't smile when Mrs. Westby brought him into the surgery a few months later. His bounding ebullience had disappeared, and he dragged himself along the passage to the consulting room. As I lifted him onto the table, I noticed that he had lost a lot of weight. "Now, what is the trouble, Mrs. Westby?" I asked. She looked at me worriedly. "He's been off colour for a few days now, listless and coughing and not eating very well. But this morning he seems quite ill, and you can see he's starting to pant." "Yes. Yes." As I inserted the thermometer, I watched the rapid rise and fall of the ribcage and noted the gaping mouth and anxious eyes. He does look very sorry for himself. His temperature was 104 degrees Fahrenheit. I took up my stethoscope and auscultated his lungs. I have heard of an old Scottish doctor describing a seriously ill patient's chest as sounding like a
"Kista whistles,"
and that just about described Brandy's. Rails, wheezes, squeaks and bubblings, they were all there against a background of laboured respiration. I put the stethoscope back in my pocket. "He's got pneumonia."
"Oh, dear."
Mrs. Westby reached out and touched the heaving chest. "That's bad, isn't it?" "Yes, I'm afraid so. But," she gave me an appealing glance, "I understand it isn't so fatal since the new drugs came out." I hesitated. "Yes, that's quite right. In humans and most animals, the sulfur drugs, and now penicillin, have changed the picture completely. But dogs are still very difficult to cure. 30 years later, it is still the same. Even with all the armory of antibiotics which followed penicillin, streptomycin, the tetracyclines and synthetics, and the new non-antibiotic drugs and steroids, I still hate to see pneumonia in a dog."
"But you don't think it's hopeless?"
Mrs. Westby asked.
No, not at all. I'm just warning you that so many dogs don't respond to treatment when they should. But Brandy is young and strong. He must stand a fair chance. I wonder what started this off anyway."
"Oh, I think I know, Mr. Herriot. He had a swim in the river about a week ago. I tried to keep him out of the water in this cold weather, but if he sees a stick floating, he just takes a dive into the middle. You've seen him. It's one of the funny little things he does."
"Yes, I know. And was he shivery afterwards?"
"He was. I walked him straight home, but it was such a freezing cold day. I could feel him trembling as I dried him down."
I nodded. "That would be the cause, all right. Anyway, let's start his treatment. I'm going to give him this injection of penicillin, and I'll call at your house tomorrow to repeat it. He's not well enough to come to the surgery."
"Very well, Mr. Herriot. Is there anything else?"
"Yes, there is. I want you to make him what we call a pneumonia jacket. Cut two holes in an old blanket for his forelegs and stitch him into it along the back. You can use an old sweater if you like, but he must have his chest warmly covered. Only let him out in the garden for necessities." I called and repeated the injection on the following day. There wasn't much change. I injected him for 4 more days, and the realization came to me sadly that Brandy was like so many of the others. He wasn't responding. The temperature did drop a little, but he ate hardly anything and grew gradually thinner. I put him on sulfapyridine tablets, but they didn't seem to make any difference. As the days passed and he continued to cough and pant and to sink deeper into a blank-eyed lethargy, I was forced more and more to the conclusion, which a few weeks ago would have seemed impossible, that this happy, bounding animal was going to die. But Brandy didn't die. He survived. You couldn't put it any higher than that. His temperature came down and his appetite improved, and he climbed onto a plateau of twilight existence where he seemed content to stay. "He isn't Brandy anymore," Mrs. Westby said one morning a few weeks later when I called in. Her eyes filled with tears as she spoke. I shook my head. "No, I'm afraid he isn't." "Are you giving him the halibut liver oil?"
"Yes, every day. but nothing seems to do him any good. Why is he like this, Mr. Herriot? Well, he has recovered from a really virulent pneumonia. But it's left him with a chronic pleurisy, adhesions, and probably other kinds of lung damage. It looks as though he's just stuck there. She dabbed at her eyes. It breaks my heart to see him like this. He's only 5, but he's like an old, old dog. He was so full of life, too. She sniffed and blew her nose. When I think of how I used to scold him for getting into the dustbins and mudding up my jeans, how I wish he would do some of his funny old tricks now. I thrust my hands deep into my pockets. Never does anything like that now, eh? No, just hangs about the house. Doesn't even want to go for a walk. As I watched, Brandy rose from his place in the corner and pottered slowly over to the fire. He stood there for a moment, gaunt and dead-eyed, and he seemed to notice me for the first time because the end of his tail gave a brief twitch before he coughed, groaned, and flopped down on the hearthrug. Mrs. Westby was right. He was like a very old dog. "Do you think he'll always be like this?" she asked. I shrugged. "We can only hope." But as I got into my car and drove away, I really didn't have much hope. I have seen calves with lung damage after bad pneumonias. They recovered, but were called bad doers because they remained thin and listless for the rest of their lives. Doctors, too, had plenty of chesty people on their books. They were more or less in the same predicament. Weeks and then months went by, and the only time I saw the Labrador was when Mrs. Westby was walking him on his lead. I always had the impression that he was reluctant to move, and his mistress had to stroll along very slowly so that he could keep up with her. The sight of him saddened me when I thought of the lolloping Brandy of old, but I told myself that at least I'd saved his life. I could do no more for him now, and I made a determined effort to push him out of my mind. In fact, I tried to forget Brandy and had managed to do so fairly well until one afternoon in February. On the previous night, I felt I had been through the fire. I had treated a colicky horse until 4 a.m. and was crawling into bed, comforted by the knowledge that the animal was settled down and free from pain, when I was called to a calving. I had managed to produce a large live calf from a small heifer, but the effort had drained the last of my strength, and when I got home it was too late to return to bed. Ploughing through the morning round, I was so tired that I felt disembodied, and at lunch Helen watched me anxiously as my head nodded over my food. There were a few dogs in the waiting room at 2 o'clock, and I dealt with them mechanically, peering through half-closed eyelids. By the time I reached my last patient, I was almost asleep on my feet. In fact, I had the feeling that I wasn't there at all.
"Next, please," I mumbled as I pushed open the waiting room door, and stood back, waiting for the usual sight of a dog being led out to the passage. But this time there was a big difference. There was a man in the doorway, all right, and he had a little poodle with him. But the thing that made my eyes snap wide open was that the dog was walking upright on his hind limbs. I knew I was half asleep, but surely I wasn't seeing things. I stared down at the dog, but the picture hadn't changed. The little creature strutted through the doorway, chest out, head up, as erect as a soldier. "Follow me, please," I said hoarsely and set off over the tiles to the consulting room. Halfway along, I just had to turn round to check the evidence of my eyes, and it was just the same. The poodle, still on his hind legs, marching along unconcernedly at his master's side. The man must have seen the bewilderment in my face, because he burst suddenly into a roar of laughter.
"Don't worry, Mr. Herriot," he said. "This little dog was circus trained before I got him as a pet. I like to show off his little tricks. This one really startles people."
"You can say that again," I said breathlessly. "He nearly gave me heart failure." The poodle wasn't ill. He just wanted his nails clipping. I smiled as I hoisted him onto the table and began to ply the clippers. "I suppose he won't want his hind claws doing," I said. "He'll have worn them down himself." I was glad to find I had recovered sufficiently to attempt a little joke. However, by the time I had finished, the old lassitude had taken over again, and I felt ready to fall down as I showed man and dog to the front door. I watched the little animal trotting away down the street, in orthodox manner this time, and it came to me suddenly that it had been a long time since I had seen a dog doing something unusual and amusing. Like the things Brandy used to do,
A wave of gentle memories flowed over me as I leant wearily against the doorpost and closed my eyes. When I opened them, I saw Brandy coming round the corner of the street with Mrs. Westby. His nose was entirely obscured by a large red tomato soup can, and he strained madly at the leash and whipped his tail when he saw me. It was certainly an hallucination this time. I was looking into the past. I really ought to go to bed immediately. But I was still rooted to the doorpost when the Labrador bounded up the steps, made an attempt, aborted by the soup can, to lick my face, and contented himself with cocking a convivial leg against the bottom step. I stared into Mrs. Westby's radiant face. What? What? With her sparkling eyes and wide smile, she looked more attractive than ever. Look, Mr. Herriot, look. He's better. He's better. In an instant, I was wide awake, and I suppose you'll want me to get that can off him. Oh, yes. Yes, please. It took all my strength to lift him onto the table. He was heavier now than before his illness. I reached for the familiar forceps and began to turn the jagged edges of the can outwards from the nose and mouth. Tomato soup must have been one of his favourites because he was really deeply embedded, and it took some time before I was able to slide the can from his face. I fought off his slobbering attack. He's back in the dustbins, I see. Yes, he is. Quite regularly. I've pulled several cans off him myself. And he goes sliding with the children, too. She smiled happily. Thoughtfully, I took my stethoscope from the pocket of my white coat and listened to his lungs. They were wonderfully clear. A slight roughness here and there, but the old cacophony had gone. I leant on the table and looked at the great dog with a mixture of thankfulness and incredulity. He was, as before, boisterous and full of the joy of living. His tongue lolled in a happy grin, and the sun glinted through the surgery window on his sleek golden coat. But Mr. Herriot? Mrs. Westby's eyes were wide. How on earth has this happened? How has he got better? Vis medicatrix naturae, I replied in tones of deep respect. I beg your pardon? The healing power of nature. Something no veterinary surgeon can compete with when he decides to act. I see. And you can never tell when this is going to happen? Nope. For a few seconds we were silent as we stroked the dog's head, ears and flanks. Oh, by the way, I said, has he shown any renewed interest in the blue jeans? Oh, my word, yes. They're in the washing machine at this very moment, absolutely covered in mud. Isn't it marvellous? Chapter 35. August the 10th, 1963. My sleep in that Bosphorus hotel seemed to last only a short time because apparently within minutes I was roused by one of the hotel staff and looked up to see the sunshine flooding into my room from the street above. I washed and shaved and hurried to the dining room. Noel and Joe had suffered from the noisy party and were looking heavy-eyed, but the captain and the rest of the crew had been sleeping at the back of the hotel and had heard practically nothing. This was a good thing because they were the ones who had a tough day ahead of them. After breakfast, the minibus whisked us along the glittering Bosphorus and through the city, where I had my second fleeting glimpse of its wonders. It was frustrating. I had hoped to explore the treasures of Istanbul at my leisure, the Blue Mosque, St. Sophia, and so many others, but maybe another day. At the airport, there was the bustle of early morning departures with aircraft taking off and climbing into the sunny sky, but I found something ominous in the sight of our Globemaster standing on his own. Vast, shabby, with the scorch marks on his useless engine. Dave, Ed and Carl didn't seem to be worried as they went over to it. The little Dane whistling, the young Americans slouching, relaxed, hands as ever buried in the pockets of their white trousers. I made straight for the BEA desk, and it was a relief to see the fresh-faced Englishman in the familiar uniform. "And what can I do for you, sir?" he asked, smiling. I brandished my checkbook. "I want 3 tickets to London on the first flight, if possible." "You want to pay by check?" "Yes, please." "I'm sorry, but we cannot accept personal checks." "What?" "I'm afraid that is the rule, sir." He was still smiling. "But we're stuck here." I gave him a brief outline of our plight. He shook his head sadly.
I do wish I could help, but I have to abide by the rules. I kept at him for a few minutes longer, but he was no good. Then, when he wasn't looking, I tried one of the other BEA officials further along, but I got the same answer. My heart was beating fast as I returned to my friends who were waiting for me in the airport lounge. They were speaking to the captain. I was beginning to feel like an expert in the bringing of evil tidings, and I hardly knew what to say to them. In fact, they took the news surprisingly well, and if they thought I was a hopeless organizer, they disguised their feelings. We all looked at the captain. "If I were you," he said, "I should go to the British consul." I turned to the farmers. "Have you ever had anything to do with consuls?" They shook their heads dumbly. "Neither have I. I don't know how they'd react in a situation like this. Would they be sure to fly us home?" "Oh, yes." The captain gave me a faint, reassuring smile. "I'm pretty certain you'd have no trouble." "Pretty certain, you say? But not absolutely?" The big man stroked his beard. "Well, Mr. Herriot, like yourself, I've never had the need to approach them." "When do you take off?"
"In about half an hour."
I had a nasty vision of the three of us trailing back into the city, being turned down by the consul, and coming back with hardly any money in our pockets to find the Globemaster gone. "Look, Captain," I said. "The way I see it, your aircraft is our only link with home. If you got us to Copenhagen, would you be able to arrange a flight to London from there?" He gave me a long, appraising stare.
"Of course. Copenhagen is our headquarters. But you would be very silly to take the chance."
"Well, I'm willing to take it. How about you chaps?" The farmers both nodded immediately.
"I'm game," Joe said. "I want to get home."
The captain looked down at him. "But you do realise there is a very real danger." Joe grinned back.
"Ah, you'll get us there, Captain. I ain't worried about that."
He was voicing my own thoughts. Captain Birch inspired confidence.
"All right, then, if you've made up your minds," the big man said. "But I'm afraid you'll have to sign a document which I must leave here in Istanbul. I'll go and draw it up now."
He paused.
"As I explained earlier, since the aircraft is in an unsafe condition, you are, in effect, unauthorized personnel. Signing this document verifies that you are aware of this and that you relinquish all rights to compensation if the worst should happen."
He swept us again with his serious gaze.
"I must point out that if you lose your lives today, your dependents will receive nothing. No insurance, nothing."
I think we all gulped a bit at this, and there was a longish silence. For once, it was Noel who broke it, and he echoed his friend.
"You'll get us there, Captain."
The document was drawn up and we signed it, and with hindsight, I know without any doubt that we behaved like complete idiots because the danger was not imaginary. We could have been killed that day. The captain's advice was right, of course. We should have gone to the British consul. Over the years, I have read frequently of football fans being flown home by the consul after getting drunk and missing charter planes. And when I think that we three were on legitimate business, it makes our decision all the more crazy. I, in particular, should have known better. I suppose part of the reason was that we were not thinking straight. The three of us were tired out with lack of sleep and the series of niggling mishaps in strange surroundings. We were in the mood to clutch at straws. In any case, the thing was done now, and we walked over the hot concrete to the Globemaster. It seemed that a fair proportion of the population of Istanbul had heard about our aircraft and had turned out to spectate because a large crowd of people watched us as we went. I had an uncomfortable feeling that they didn't expect us to get off the ground. When we climbed into the aircraft, I saw that the interior had been swept clean and that a large door had been removed from one side of the fuselage to allow aeration after the cattle had gone. Joe elected to sit up front in the flight cabin, while Noel and I strapped ourselves into two drop-down seats at the very back. We felt very insignificant sitting there in the tail, looking at the yawning emptiness in front of us. We couldn't see what was happening, and it was a shock when the engines roared into life. With that big opening in the side, the noise was intolerable, and we both instinctively pushed our fingers into our ears.
Noel's face worked and his mouth opened and closed soundlessly as he tried to talk to me. I knew we couldn't stand this for long, and I reached for my bag. I pulled out some cotton wool and stuffed it into the farmer's ears. I did the same for myself, and there was no doubt it relieved the noise problem. But at the same time, it gave me a strange, unreal feeling as if I were in limbo. From the jerkings and vibrations, I deduced that we were taxiing to the end of the runway prior to takeoff. Then we stopped, and I knew we were in position. The roar of the engines increased to a deep-throated bellow, which penetrated the earplugs and made my head spin. I looked at Noel, and he shaped his lips into, "Taking off now." I nodded encouragingly. I don't know what his emotions were, but I felt utterly fatalistic about the whole thing. I'm not brave, but I've always felt like that about flying, and though this was a very special case, my attitude was the same. For a long time, we sat there listening to the roar and feeling the great aircraft shaking under and around us. This went on and on until I began to wonder if we had in fact left the ground. Noel's puzzled face and the spreading of his hands told me he was thinking the same thing. After another 5 minutes, I decided we must be high in the air by now, but I had to have a look to make sure. I unstrapped myself and crawled on hands and knees to the open side. I pushed my head out and looked down, and with a jolt of disappointment saw the grey concrete of the runway a few feet below. I slithered back to my place and shook my head at Noel. What, I wondered, was going on? Could the captain not get up enough power, or was he just giving his three remaining engines a long test before making his attempt? I think it must have been the latter, because suddenly we were underway. We couldn't see anything, but the surge forward was unmistakable. There were a tense few seconds as the vibration rose to a crescendo, then a calm which told us we were airborne. I felt the impact of the undercarriage thudding into place, and I pictured Carl and his friends hauling it up over the last few inches. I leant back in my seat. The first obstacle was behind us. The feeling of relief seemed to affect Noel immediately, because when I looked round, he was sound asleep, slumped against the webbing strap. My natural curiosity was too much for me, and I returned to the gap in the fuselage to view the scene passing below. I sat there entranced all day, the cotton wool plugs dangling from my ears. It wasn't like flying in a modern jet where you can't see much else beside clouds. I watched an unfolding, ever-changing panorama of mountains and sea, islands, yellow beaches, arid plains, the tightly clustered houses of large cities and tiny villages. Occasionally, I took pictures leaning precariously against the strip of sacking, which was the only thing between me and the dazzling blue water thousands of feet below. In mid-afternoon, I broke off to consume the contents of a white carton which the captain had solemnly handed out to each of us in Istanbul. It contained a slab of unidentifiable meat, the inevitable sticky cake, and to my delight, some slices of that delicious bread and a wedge of cheese. I also went up to the flight cabin for a few minutes to get some pictures of the stricken engine with its four propeller blades dangling still and useless. It was a sad sight, but I was glad to see that the other three engines were buzzing away with heartening vigour. When I returned to my post by the open side, the great rampart of the Alps was rising before us. This, I knew, was the crucial time. The Globemaster climbed higher, but when we reached the tumbled mass of peaks, we still seemed to be very near to the summit. Beneath me, I could see the loose boulders and scarred rock on the mountaintops quite plainly. But like my friends, I had faith in that bearded man's ability to take us over. And he did. It was growing dusk when we circled over Copenhagen, and I had a glimpse of the Little Mermaid in the bay. Soon Joe was happy at last, with a glass of real beer in his hand in the airport bar. There isn't much more to tell. We had to wait till 2 a.m. for a flight to Heathrow, and I was sitting on a luggage barrow trying to read the Sunday Times at 7 o'clock in the morning at King's Cross Station. I wasn't very successful because the paper kept slipping from my fingers as my eyes closed involuntarily. My last memory is of a friendly old gentleman in the compartment of the northbound train trying to engage me in conversation, but to my shame I fell asleep in front of him and didn't wake up until York. After I got back into the routine of the practice, I looked back on my Istanbul trip as an interesting experience. A bit too concentrated, perhaps, and by no means the rescuer my friend John had pictured, but fascinating in its way. And of course I felt I had greatly exaggerated any possible danger on the flight home. From the comfort of my car as I drove round the familiar roads of the Yorkshire Dales, the whole thing had a touch of fantasy. It all came back to me in stark truth when I heard, many months later, that soon after the Istanbul flight, the Globemaster had plunged into the Mediterranean with the loss of all her crew. The news came to me indirectly, and I did my best to find out if it was true, but it was a long time afterwards and I had no success. Ever since, I have thought often about those men. The captain, the two young Americans, and Carl. During those few days, I had come to admire them. And even now, I still cling to the faint hope that that terrible news was wrong. Chapter 36. What horrible little dogs. It was a sentiment which rarely entered my mind, because I could find something attractive in nearly all my canine patients. I had to make an exception in the cases of Ruffles and Muffles Whithorn. Try as I might, I could find no lovable traits, only unpleasant ones, like their unvarying method of welcoming me into their home. "Down, down!" I yelped, as I always did. The two little animals, West Highland Whites, were standing on their hind limbs, clawing furiously at my trouser legs with their front paws. I don't know whether I have unusually tender shins, but the effect was agonizing. As I backed away on tiptoe like a ballet dancer going into reverse, the room resounded to Mr. and Mrs. Whithorn's delighted laughter. They found this unfeignedly amusing.
"Aren't they little pets?"
Mr. Whithorn gasped between paroxysms. "Don't they give you a lovely greeting, bless them?" I wasn't so sure about that. Apart from excoriating my flesh through my grey flannels, the dogs were glaring up at me balefully, their mouths half open, lips quivering, teeth chattering in a characteristic manner. It wasn't exactly a snarl, but it wasn't friendly either.
"Come, my darlings."
The man gathered the dogs into his arms and kissed them both fondly on the cheeks. He was still giggling.
"You know, Mr. Herriot, isn't it priceless that they welcome you into our house so lovingly and then try to stop you from leaving?"
I didn't say anything but massaged my trousers in silence. The truth was that these animals invariably clawed me on my entry, then did their best to bite my ankles on the way out. In between, they molested me in whatever ways they could devise. The strange thing was that they were both old. Ruffles 14 and Muffles 12, and one might have experienced some mellowness in their characters, but it was not so. "Well," I said after reassuring myself that my wounds were superficial, "I understand Ruffles is lame."
"Yes."
Mrs. Whithorn took the dog and placed him on the table where she had spread some newspapers.
"It's his left front paw. Just started this morning. He's in agony, poor dear."
Gingerly, I took hold of the foot, then whipped my hand away as the teeth snapped shut less than an inch from my fingers.
"Oh, my precious," Mrs. Whithorn exclaimed. "It's so painful. Do be careful, Mr. Herriot. He's so nervous, and I think you're hurting him."
I breathed deeply. This dog should have had a tape muzzle applied right at the start, but I had previously caused shock and dismay at the Whithorns by suggesting such a thing, so I had to manage as best I could. Anyway, I wasn't a novice at the business. It would take a very smart biter to catch me. I curled my forefinger round the leg and had another look, and I was able to see what I wanted in the fleeting instant before the next snap, a reddish swelling pouting from between the toes, an interdigital cyst. How ridiculous that a vet should be making a house call for such a trivial ailment. But the Whithorns had always firmly refused to bring their dogs to the surgery. "It frightened the darlings," they said. I stood back from the table. "This is just a harmless cyst, but I agree that it is painful, so I'd advise you to bathe it in hot water until it bursts, and that will relieve the pain. Many dogs burst these themselves by nibbling at them, but you can hasten the process. I drew some antibiotic into a syringe. Nobody knows exactly what causes an interdigital cyst. No specific causal organisms have been found, but I'll give them this shot in case of infection. I achieved the injection by holding the little animal by the scruff of the neck. Then Mrs. Whithorn lifted the other dog onto the table. "You better give him a check-up while you're here," she said. This usually happened, and I palpated the snarling bundle of white hair and went over him with a stethoscope and thermometer. He had most of the afflictions which beset old dogs, arthritis, nephritis and other things, including a heart murmur which was difficult to hear among the bad-tempered rumblings which echoed round his thorax. My examination completed, I replenished his various medicaments and prepared to leave. This was when the exit phase of my visit started, and it was relished by Mr. and Mrs. Whithorn even more than the entry. The ritual never changed. As their owners tittered gleefully, the two little dogs stationed themselves in the doorway, effectively barring my way out. Their lips were drawn back from their teeth. They were the very picture of venom. To draw them away from their posts, I feinted to the right, then made a rush for the door, but with my fingers on the handle, I had to turn and fend off the hungry jaws snapping at my ankles. And as I skipped around on my heels, my previous dainty ballet steps were superseded by the coarser hoppings of a clog dance. But I escaped. A final couple of quick pushes with my feet, and I was out in the fresh air, crashing the door thankfully behind me. I was regaining my breath when Doug Watson, the milkman, drew up in his blue van. He kept a few dairy cows on a small holding on the edge of town, and augmented his income by operating a retail round among the citizens of Darrowby. "Morning, Mr. Herriot," he gestured towards the house. "You been in to see them dogs?" "Yes." "Proper little sods, aren't they?" I laughed. "Not very sweet-tempered." "By gaw, that's the truth. I've got to watch myself when I deliver milk. If that door happens to be open, they're straight out at me." "I'll bet they are." His eyes widened. "They go for me feet. Sometimes I feel a right bloody Charlie jumping about like a daft thing in front of everybody." I nodded. "I know exactly how you feel." "You've got to keep moving or you've had it," he said. "Look here." He pushed his leg out of the van and pointed to the heel of one of his Wellington boots he always wore on his rounds. I could see a neat puncture hole on either side. "One of them got me there just t'other day. Went right through to me skin." "Good heavens, which one did that?" "Don't rightly know. What's their names, anyway?"
"Ruffles and Muffles," I replied.
"Bloody hell!"
Doug looked at me wonderingly. His own dog was called Spot. He spent a few moments in thought, then raised a finger. "But I'll tell thou summat, and maybe you won't believe me. Them dogs used to be real nice little things."
"What? I'm not joking nor jesting. When they first came here, they were as friendly as any dogs I've ever seen."
"It was afore your time, but it's true."
"Well, that's remarkable," I said. "I wonder what happened."
Doug shrugged his shoulders.
"God knows. But each of them turned nasty after a few months, and they've got worse and worse ever since."
Doug's words stayed with me until I got back to the surgery. I was puzzled. Westies, in my experience, were a particularly amiable breed. Siegfried was in the dispensary writing directions on a bottle of colic mixture. I mentioned the situation to him.
"Yes," he said, "I've heard the same thing. I've been to the Whithorns a couple of times, and I know why those dogs are so objectionable."
"Really? Why is it?"
"Their owners make them that way. They never correct them, and they slobber over them all the time."
"You could be right," I said. "I've always made a fuss of my own dogs, but all that kissing and cuddling is a bit sickening."
"Quite. Too much of that is bad for a dog. And another thing, those two animals are the bosses in that home. A dog likes to obey. It gives them security. Believe me, Ruffles and Muffles would be happy and good-tempered if they'd been controlled right from the start."
"Well, there's no doubt they rule the roost now."
"Absolutely," Siegfried said, "and really they hate it. If only the Whithorns would take off those rose-tinted spectacles and treat them normally. But it's too late now, I'm afraid."
He pocketed the colic mixture and left. The months passed. I had a few more visits to the Whithorns and went through the usual dancing routine. Then, oddly, both the old dogs died within a few weeks of each other. And despite their tempestuous lives, they had peaceful ends. Ruffles was found dead in his basket one morning,
and Muffles wandered down the garden for a sleep under the apple tree and never woke up. That was merciful anyway. They hadn't treated me very well, but I was glad they had been spared the things which upset me most in small animal practice. The road accident, the lingering illness, the euthanasia. It was like a chapter in my life closing, but shortly afterwards Mr. Whithorn rang me.
"Mr. Herriot," he said, "we have acquired another pair of Westies, and I wonder if you'd call and give them their distemper inoculations."
It was a delightful change to go into the room and be met by two tail-wagging puppies. They were 12 weeks old, and they looked up at me with benevolent eyes.
"They're beautiful," I said.
"What have you called them?"
"Ruffles and Muffles,"
Mr. Whithorn replied.
"Same again, eh?" "Yes, we wanted to keep the memory of our other darlings alive."
He seized the puppies and showered kisses on them. After the inoculations, it was a long time before I saw the little dogs again. They seemed to be singularly healthy. It must have been nearly a year later when I was called to the house to give them a check-up. When I went into the sitting room, Ruffles and Muffles, Mark II, were seated side by side on the sofa. There was an odd immobility in their attitude. As I approached, they stared at me coldly, and, as if responding to a signal, they bared their teeth and growled, softly but menacingly. A chill ran through me. It couldn't be happening all over again. But as Mr. Whithorn lifted Ruffles onto the table and I took the horoscope from its box, I quickly realized that fate had turned the clock back. The little animal stood there regarding me with bristling mistrust. "Hold his head, will you, please?" I said. "I want to examine his ears first." I took the ear between finger and thumb and gently inserted the horoscope. I applied my eye to the instrument and was inspecting the external meters when the dog exploded into action. I heard a vicious snarl, and as I jerked my head back, the draft of the crunching teeth fanned my face. Mr. Whithorn leant back and abandoned himself to mirth.
"Oh, isn't he a little monkey? He just won't stand any nonsense."
He rested his hands on the table for some time, shaking with merriment. Then he wiped his eyes.
"Dear, oh dear, what a character he is."
I stared at the man. The fact that he might have easily been confronted by a noseless veterinary surgeon did not seem to weigh with him. I looked too at his wife standing behind him. She was laughing just as merrily. What was the use of trying to instill reason into these people? They were utterly besotted. All I could do was get on with the job. "Mr. Whithorn," I said tautly, "will you please hold him again, and this time take a tight grip with your hands on either side of his neck?" He looked at me anxiously. "But I won't hurt the little pet." "No, no, of course not." "All right." He placed his cheek against the dog's face and whispered lovingly, "Daddy promises to be gentle, my angel. Don't worry, sweetheart." He grasped the loose skin of the neck as I directed, and I warily recommenced operations. Peering at the interior of the ear, listening to Mr. Whithorn's murmured endearments, I was tensed in readiness for another explosion. But when it came with a ferocious yap, I found I was in no danger because Ruffles had turned his attention elsewhere. As I dropped the horoscope and jumped back, I saw that the dog had sunk his teeth into the ball of his master's thumb. And it wasn't an ordinary bite. He was hanging on, grinding deeply into the flesh. Mr. Whithorn emitted a piercing yell of agony before shaking himself free.
"You rotten little bugger!"
he screamed, dancing around the room, holding the stricken hand. He looked at the blood pouring from the two deep holes, then glared at Ruffles.
"Oh, you bloody little swine!"
I thought of Siegfried's words and of his wish that these people might take a more sensible view of their dogs. Well, this could be a start. Chapter 37.
"Are you all right, Mr. Herriot?"
Lionel Bruff looked down at me solicitously as I crawled on hands and knees through the gap in the wire netting.
"Yes,"
I gasped. Lionel was very thin, and he had slipped through the aperture like a snake, but I was having a little difficulty. There were some unusual farms and small holdings in our practice, converted railway wagons, hen houses and other artifices. But this one, I always thought,
took the prize. Lionel was one of a plentiful breed in those days, a roadman who kept livestock as a sideline and hobby. Some of them had 4 cows, others a few pigs, but Lionel had the lot. He had housed his motley collection in a large hut by the side of his cottage. He appeared to have divided the hut into sections by using the first thing which came to hand. It was a labyrinth, a monumental piece of improvisation, with upended bed frames, sheets of plywood and corrugated iron, and stretches of wire netting separating the animals. There were no doors or passages anywhere. I got to my feet, puffing slightly. "Where's this calf?" "Not far to go now, Mr. Herriot." We passed his solitary cow, then little pigs nibbled at my heels as Lionel laboriously undid a series of knots tied with coarse string so that we could enter the next compartment. Here, a couple of nanny goats regarded us impassively. "Grand milkers, them two," the roadman grunted. "Missy's makes some smashing cheese from them, and it's healthy milk, isn't it?" "That's right, it is." At that time, when TB infection was still a constant threat, the milk from the comparatively immune goat was highly regarded. The far wall of their pen consisted of a mahogany dining table lying on its side, its legs projecting into the interior. I skirted it warily before climbing over. I had suffered some nasty blows from those casted knobs. We were among the calves now, 3 of them, and it was easy to pick out my patient, a small black animal with a purulent discharge crusting his nostrils. As I bent to take his temperature, I had to push aside a couple of squawking hens, and a fat Muscovy duck waddled out of my way. These feathered creatures seemed to have the run of the place, jumping and fluttering from pen to pen and in and out of the building. From my position by the calf, I could see an assortment of cats perched on windowsills or on the tops of partitions. A sudden snarling from the end of the hut marked the beginning of a friendly fight between Lionel's 3 dogs. Beyond the doorway, 2 sheep were visible, grazing contentedly in the field by the cottage. I looked at the thermometer. 103. Then I auscultated the chest with my stethoscope. "Just a touch of bronchitis, Lionel, but I'm glad you called me. He's quite rough in his lungs, and pneumonia could be just round the corner. As it is, a couple of injections will probably clear him up." Lionel nodded in quiet satisfaction. He was a vague man, but kind, and all his animals were comfortable and well-fed in their eccentric dwelling. Deep straw abounded, and the hay racks and troughs were well supplied. I felt in my pockets. They were bulging with bottles and syringes. I had brought everything I might possibly need. On this establishment, it wasn't easy to slip back to the car as an afterthought. After the injection, I turned to the roadman. "I'll look in tomorrow morning. It's Sunday, so you won't be working, eh?" "That's right. Thank you, Mr. Herriot." He turned and began to lead me back through the obstacle course. On the following day, I found the calf greatly improved. "Temperature normal, Lionel," I said. "And he's on his feet now. That's a good sign." The roadman nodded abstractedly, and I could see that his mind was elsewhere. "Aye, well, that's grand. I'm right pleased." His eyes looked past me vacantly for a few moments, then he suddenly seemed to come back to the world. "Mr. Herriot." His voice took on an unaccustomed urgency. "There's something I want to ask you."
"Oh, yes?"
"Aye, I'll tell you what it is." He looked at me eagerly. "I fancy going in for pigs in a big way."
"You mean keep a lot of pigs?"
"That's right.
Just pigs and nowt else, and keep them in a proper place."
"But that would mean building a piggery."
He thumped a fist into his palm. "You've just said it. That's what I fancy. I've always liked pigs, and I'd like to do the job proper. I could build a piggery out there in field."
I looked at him in surprise. "But Lionel, these things cost a lot. There's the question of..."
"Money? Oh, I've got money. Remember me our uncle died a bit back? Lived with us for years. Well, he left me a little legacy. Not a fortune, thou knows. But I could branch out a bit now."
"Well, it's up to you, of course," I said. "But are you sure it's what you really want? You've always seemed to be happy with your bit of stock here, and you're not a youngster. You'll be 50-odd, won't you?"
"Aye, I'm 56, but they say you're never too old to have a go at something new."
I smiled.
"Oh, I'm a strong believer in that. I'm all for it, providing you're happy doing it."
He looked very thoughtful and scratched his cheek a few times.
I suppose, like most happy men, he didn't realise it.
Get by, duck!
He grunted with a flash of irritation and nudged the Muscovy duck with his toe as it tried to march between his legs. Still deep in thought, he bent and lifted a hen's egg from the straw in the corner and put it in his pocket.
Nay, I thought it over for a bit now and my mind's made up. I've got to have a go.
Okay, Lionel, I said. Have at it, and the best of luck. With a speed unusual in the Dales, the piggery took shape in the field. Rows of concrete pens with a covered yard appeared, and within a few weeks, sows and a boar were installed in the pens and a solid bunch of porkers grunted among the straw in the yard. To me, this modern structure looked out of place, with the ancient dry stone walls encircling its green setting, and the smooth bulk of the fell rising to the stark moorland above. But I hoped it would bring Lionel the satisfaction he craved. He still carried on with his road work. He had to get up earlier in the morning to feed and clean out his pigs, but he was a fit man and seemed to be enjoying it. His vet bills went up, of course, but there was nothing serious, and everything I treated went on well. An occasional sow with mastitis, a farrowing, a few piglets with joint ill. He accepted these things without complaint, because the old adage, "Where there's stock, there's trouble," was as familiar to him as to anybody else. The only thing that bothered me a little was that whereas before he spent a lot of time leaning on his various partitions looking at his animals and smoking his pipe, he now had no time for that. He was always bustling about, pushing wheelbarrows, filling up troughs, mucking out, and it seemed to me that all this was foreign to his nature. He certainly wasn't as relaxed as he had been. He was happy enough, caring for his fine new charges, but there was a tautness in his expression, a slight anxiety which had not been there before. There was anxiety in his voice, too, when he rang up one evening.
"Just got back from work, Mr. Herriot, and there's some young pigs here I don't like the look of."
"What symptoms are they showing, Lionel?"
"Well, they haven't been doing right for a bit. Not thriving like the others. But they've been eating and not really off it, like, so I haven't bothered you.
But how about now?" There was a pause.
"They look different now. They're kind of crambly on their back legs and they're scouring a bit. And there's one dead. I'm a bit worried."
I was worried too, instantly and profoundly. It sounded horribly like swine fever. In my early days, those two words were burned into my soul, and yet to the modern young vet, they don't mean a thing. For around 20 years, I was literally haunted by swine fever. Whenever I did a post-mortem on a dead pig, I feared I might come across the dreaded button ulcers and hemorrhages. And what I feared still more was that I might fail to spot the disease and be responsible for its spread. It wasn't as bad as foot and mouth in that respect, but the same principles held good. If I didn't recognise the symptoms, pigs might go from that farm to a market and be sold to places scattered over many miles, and every pig would carry its own load of infection and would spread the incurable disease among its healthy neighbours. Then the Ministry of Agriculture would be called in, and they would painstakingly trace the thing right back to Herriot, the man who had made the original unforgivable blunder. It was a recurring nightmare, because unlike foot and mouth, the disease was a common one, waiting round the corner all the time. I often used to think I would be blissfully happy if only there was no such thing as swine fever. In fact, when I look back at all the worry it caused me, and my contemporaries, I feel that the present-day veterinarians should leap happily from their beds each morning and dance around the room crying out, "Hurrah! Hurrah! There's no swine fever now!" At the farm, Lionel led me to a pen at the far end of the yard. "They're in there," he said gloomily. I leant over the wall, and a wave of misery flowed through me. There were about a dozen young pigs in the pen, around 16 weeks old, and they were nearly all showing the same symptoms. They were thin and had a scruffy, unthrifty look. The backs of their ears were a dark purple-red. They staggered slightly as they walked, and a thin diarrhea ran down the limp-hanging tails. I took a few temperatures. They were around 106 degrees Fahrenheit. It was classical, straight out of the book. But I didn't tell Lionel right away. In fact, I wasn't allowed to until I had gone through all the ritual.
"Where did you get this lot?" I asked.
"Haverton Market.
They were a right good level bunch when they came, but by God, they've gone down."
He pushed at a little corpse with his Wellington.
"And now I've got this dead un."
"Yes. Well, I'll have to open him up and look inside him, Lionel. My voice sounded weary. I was starting again on the agonizing merry-go-round. I'll get my knife from the car. I came back with the post-mortem knife, rolled the dead pig on its back and slit open the abdomen. How often had I done this with just the same feeling of taut apprehension? The region of the ileocecal valve was the textbook site, and I aimed for it first. But as I cut into the intestine and scraped the mucosa with my knife, I found only hemorrhages and small necrotic spots, some dark red, others yellowish. Sometimes you found the real thing further along in the colon, and for a long time I snipped my way along the coils of bowel with my scissors without finding anything definite. Here I was again. I was sure this was swine fever, but I couldn't say so to the farmer. The ministry insisted that theirs was the right of diagnosis, and until they issued confirmation, I could say nothing. There were the usual petechial hemorrhages in kidney and bladder, but not one typical ulcer. I sat back on my heels. Lionel, I'm very sorry, but I'll have to report this as a suspected case of swine fever. Oh, well, that's bad, isn't it? Yes. Yes, it is, but we can't be positive until the ministry confirm it. I'm going to take samples and send them off to the laboratory in Surrey. And can't you do out to cure them? No, I'm afraid not. It's a virus, you see. There's no cure. How about t'others? Does it spread? I cringed at having to answer, but there was no point in playing the thing down. Yes, it spreads like anything. You'll have to take every precaution. Keep a tray of disinfectant outside this pen and dip your boots if you have to go in. In fact, I would go in as little as possible. Feed and water them over the top and always attend to the healthy pigs first. But how about if mule pigs get it? How many are going to die? Another horrible question. The books say the mortality rate is 80 to 100%. In my experience, it had been 100%. I took a long breath. Lionel, they could all die. The roadman looked slowly over the rows of new concrete pens with their sows and litters, and the pigs rooting happily among the straw in the yard. I felt I had to say something, however lame. Anyway, it might not be what I fear. I'll send these samples off to the lab and let you know what they say. In the meantime, get those powders into them, either in their food or by dosing. I stowed the loops of bowel in my car boot, then went round the piggery making notes of the different grades of pigs, because another little purgatory lay ahead of me. The filling up of the forms. I have a blind spot where forms are concerned, and the swine fever form was a horrendous pink thing about 2 feet long with closely packed questions on each side about how many sows and boars and unweaned pigs and fattening pigs, and heaven help you if you got any of the numbers wrong. That evening at Skeldale House, I wrestled with this pink thing for a long time, then turned to the real horror, the packing of the sample of bowel. The ministry provided a special outfit for this purpose. At first sight, it looked like a flat square of corrugated cardboard, some pieces of greaseproof paper, several lengths of hairy string, and a sheet of brown paper. However, on closer examination, you found that the cardboard folded into a small square box. The instructions were very explicit. You didn't just bung a piece of bowel into the box. You had to lay a 3 feet portion lengthwise on the greaseproof paper, then fold the ends of the paper inwards and tie the whole thing up in one of the pieces of string. However, there was a catch here, because among the swine fever kit were 2 stridently printed red and black cards saying, "Pathological specimen, urgent," and with spaces for the address of the infected premises and all kinds of things. These cards had holes in each end, and the string containing the bowel had to be threaded through these holes before the box was closed. The other card went on the outside. I painstakingly went through the ritual. And as I finally fumbled the string through the holes in the outside card and tied the box in the brown paper, I fell back exhausted, because this sort of thing took more out of me than carving cows. It was then, just as I was staring with glazed eyes at the envelopes containing the form for head office and the one for divisional office and the cardboard creation packed at last, that I saw the other card lying on the table. I had forgotten to include it with the contents.
"Damn and blast it to hell!" I yelled. "I always do that. I bloody well always do that."
Helen must have thought I might have had some sort of seizure because she hurried through to the dispensary where I was working. "Are you all right?" she asked anxiously. I hung my head and nodded weakly. "Yes, sorry. It's just this damned swine fever." "Well, all right, Jim." She looked at me doubtfully, "but try to keep your voice down. You'll wake the children." In grim silence, I dismantled the box, threaded the card, and reconstructed the outfit once more. I had done this so often, and oh, how I hated it. I thought bitterly that if ever I wanted something to fill in a quiet evening, I only had to do an SF report. I took the thing to the station and sent it off. And in an attempt to ease my mind, I turned to one of my veterinary Bibles, Udall's Practice of Veterinary Medicine. Even among those hallowed pages, I found little comfort. The great man's pronouncements only confirmed my suspicions. He was an American, and he called it hog cholera, but everything he described reminded me of what I had seen on Lionel's place. He talked about injection of serum to protect the healthy pigs, but I had tried that, and it just didn't work. It would be more expense for Lionel with nothing to show for it. As I slit the intestine along its length, I really thought I'd found something definite. Surely those ulcers were slightly raised and concentric. The ministry must confirm it this time, and then at least we would know where we were. I had another evening of form-filling and another struggle with the cardboard box and the papers, but as I sent off the samples, I was hopeful that my doubts would be resolved. When the word came back that the ministry were once more unable to confirm the disease, I could have cried. I appealed to Siegfried. What the hell are they playing at? Can you tell me how they ever diagnose SF from these samples at the lab? Oh, yes. My partner looked at me gravely. They take the length of bowel from the paper and throw it against the ceiling. If it sticks there, it's positive. If it falls off, it's negative. I gave a hollow laugh. I've heard that one before, and sometimes I feel like believing it. But don't be too hard on the ministry boys, Siegfried said. Remember, they have to be dead sure before they confirm. They'd look damn silly if they were wrong. Lots of things can look like SF. You find necrotic ulcers in worm infestations, for instance. It's not easy. I groaned. Oh, I know. I'm not blaming them, really. It's just that poor old Lionel Bruff is sitting on the edge of a precipice and I can't do anything to help him. Yes, James, it's a hell of a situation. I've been there and I know. 2 days later, Lionel rang to say he had another dead pig. This time I found more typical ulcers, and though I still had no idea what the ministry would say, I knew exactly what I had to do. My brain seemed to have worked it out during the night hours because my decision was crystal clear. Lionel, I said, you've got to slaughter every healthy pig on the place. His eyes widened. But there's hardly any of them ready for killing yet. And there's in pig sows and all sorts. Yes, I know, but if the disease had been confirmed, I would have advised you to get rid of them all. You are under restrictions, as you know, and you can't send any pigs to the market. But I can give you a license for all the healthy pigs to go to the bacon factory. Aye, but I can understand how you feel, Lionel. It's tragic, but if once the disease gets among your other pigs, I won't be able to give you a license then. And you'll just have to watch them die. This way I can save you about a couple of £1,000. But the bacon pigs, the porkers, I'll get a lot more in 2 months from now. Yes, but you get something for them now. And nothing if they get swine fever. And apart from the money, wouldn't you rather have your pigs humanely slaughtered than see them waste away like this sick lot? My words brought home to me the fundamental sadness of a country vet's work. That so many of our patients are ultimately destined for the butcher's hook, and no matter how attractive farm animals may be,
All our activities have a commercial foundation.
Well, I don't know.
It's a big thing. He looked again over the new piggery and the animals he had tended so carefully. Then he turned and gave me a level stare.
And what if it isn't swine fever?
He had me there. Under those steady eyes, I could only give him an honest answer. If it isn't, Lionel, I'll be costing you thousands instead of saving you thousands.
Aye, I see that. But you think it is.
As I told you before, I am not allowed to make an official diagnosis. But in my own mind, I'm bloody sure it is. He nodded quickly.
Right, Mr. Herriot, start making out your licenses. I've got a bit of faith in you.
A bit of faith was a tremendous compliment from a plain Yorkshireman, and I hoped fervently that he was not misplaced. I got out my blue forms and started to write. It wasn't long before the new piggery was an empty, silent place. There remained only the pen of affected animals, and they died off rapidly. With all its terrors, I am sure that swine fever was not a painful disease, and the one gleam of light in the little tragedy was that the diseased pigs quietly faded away, and the others had a humane end. There was no real suffering. Towards the end of the episode, I heard from the ministry that they had confirmed the disease. I showed the letter to Lionel, and he put his spectacles on and read it through very carefully.
You were right, then, he said. So it were a good job we did what we did.
He folded the paper and handed it back to me.
I got a nice bit from the factory for them pigs we sent in, and if we'd hung on, I'd have gotten out. I'm grateful to you.
So that was what I got from that simple roadman after he had seen his dream collapse and melt away. No moaning, no complaints, only gratitude. Different people reacted in different ways when they were ravaged by this terrible thing, but thank heaven it is all in the past now. A crystal violet vaccine was introduced, and this helped to control the disease. But finally, the ministry started a compulsory slaughter policy as in foot in mouth, and that was the end of swine fever. It must be nearly 30 years since I had to witness these disasters and wrestle with the forms and boxes and greaseproof papers, but the memory still lingers. In the meantime, I wondered what Lionel would do with his new building. When the last pig had gone, he meticulously cleaned out and disinfected the place, but he didn't say anything about his intentions. When the place had stood empty for 4 months, I concluded that he'd had enough of large-scale farming, but I was wrong. One evening, when I had finished seeing a few dogs and cats, I found him sitting in the corner of the waiting room. "Mr. Herriot," he said without preamble, "I want to start again."
"You mean with pigs?"
"Aye.
I want to fill that place up again. Can't bear seeing it standing empty."
I looked at him thoughtfully. "Are you absolutely sure? You took a nasty knock last time. I thought he might have put you off."
Nay, I still have this feeling. I want to be in pigs."
"There's just one thing, and that's what I've come to ask you. Could there be any of them germs left from last do?" It was the sort of question I don't like being asked. In theory, the infections should have died out in that place long ago. But I'd heard some funny things about the swine fever virus surviving for long periods, but 4 months. The place must be safe by now. Anyway, it's not much help when a vet says he doesn't know. This man wanted an answer. "I'm sure it would be safe to bring more pigs up now, if you've quite made up your mind."
Right. I'll get started again."
He turned and left me as though he couldn't begin quickly enough. And indeed, it wasn't long before the piggery echoed once more to the grunts, snorts and squeals of a new colony. And it wasn't long either before trouble struck. Lionel's voice on the phone was more agitated than I'd ever heard it. "I've just got back from me work and me pigs are in hell of a state. Laid out all over the place." My heart gave one mighty wallop against my ribs. "What do you mean, laid out?"
"Well, it's like they're taking fits. Fits. Aye, they're on their sides, kicking and slavering, and when they get up, they stagger around and fall down again. I'll be right out."
The receiver rattled on its rest as I replaced it. I felt suddenly drained. I had advised this poor man that it was safe to restock, and there was no doubt swine fever could display nervous symptoms. I rushed for Udall and whipped through the pages. Yes, by God, there it was. Motor irritation may be noted in the beginning in the form of circling, muscular twitchings, and even convulsions. I didn't see a thing as I threw my car at full speed along the narrow road. I never even noticed the trees speeding past the windows or the green fell rising beyond. I had only a horrid mental picture of what was waiting for me at the other end. And it was worse than I expected. Much worse. The yard was littered with pigs of all sizes, from young stores to big pregnant sows. Some of them were reeling and toppling in the straw, but most were on their sides, foaming at the mouth, trembling and pedalling frantically with their feet at the empty air. Udall had talked about convulsions, and, dear God, I had never seen worse convulsions than these. Pale-faced and wordless, Lionel led me round the pens. Suckling sows lay twitching as their litters fought at their udders for milk. The boar paced around his area like a blind thing, bumping into the walls, then sitting down dog-like in a stupor. There was hardly a normal animal on the place. The roadman turned to me with an attempt at a smile.
Well, we can't license off the Elthians this time. There aren't any.
I shook my head dumbly. I was utterly bewildered. I found my voice at last. When did this start?
They were all as right as ninepence this morning. Tall lot of them, bawling for their grub like the others do. Then when I come home, they were like this.
But damn it, Lionel, I said almost in a shout. It's too sudden. It doesn't make sense. He nodded.
Ah, that's what Plummer said when he saw him. Got a bit of a shock, did fella.
Plummer?
Aye. The missus noticed at dinner time that pigs had no water. She sent for Fred Buller and he came out this afternoon. Said there was a blockage in the pipe somewhere. He's put it right now.
Then they've been without water most of the day?
I reckon so. They must have.
Oh, glory be, now I knew! I was still full of apprehension, but the weight of guilt was suddenly lifted from me. Whatever happened now, it wasn't my fault.
So that's it, I gasped.
Lionel looked at me questioningly.
What do you mean? The water? That'd only make them a bit thirsty.
They're not thirsty. They've got salt poisoning.
Salt poisoning? But they haven't had no salt.
Yes, they have. There's salt in nearly all pig meal. My mind was racing. What was the first thing to do? I grabbed his arm and hustled him into the yard. Come on, let's get some of those pigs onto their feet.
But they've always had the same meal. What's happened today?
He looked mystified as we trotted through the straw. I selected a big sow which was lying quiet between convulsions and started to push at her shoulder.
They've been without water. That's what happened.
And that causes a higher concentration of salt in the brain. Gives them fits.
Push, Lionel, push! We've got to get her over to that trough. There's plenty of water in there now.
I could see he thought I was raving, but he helped me to raise the sow to her feet, and we supported her on either side as she tottered up to the long metal trough which bounded one side of the yard. She took a few gulps of water, then collapsed. Lionel took a few panting breaths.
She hasn't had much.
No, and that's a good thing. Too much makes them worse. Let's try this other pig. She's lying very still.
Makes him worse.
He began to help me to lift.
How the hell's that?
Never mind, I puffed. It just does. I couldn't very well tell him that I didn't know myself, that I'd never seen salt poisoning before and that I was only going by the book. He groaned as we pushed the second pig towards the trough.
God help us, this is a bloody funny carry-on. I've never seen out like this.
Neither have I thought. And I only hoped all those things I was taught at college were true. We spent a busy hour assisting the stricken animals to the water or carefully dosing them when they were unable to move. We did this by pushing a Wellington boot with the toe cut off into the mouths and pouring the water down the leg of the boot. A pig would certainly crunch the neck of a glass bottle. The animals with the most powerful convulsions I injected with a sedative to control the spasms. When we had finished, I looked around the piggery. All the animals had got some water into them and were lying within easy reach of the troughs. As I watched, several of them got up, took a few swallows, then lay down. That was just what I wanted.
Well, I said wearily, we can't do any more.
He shrugged.
Right. Come in and have a cup of tea.
As I followed him to the house, I could tell by the droop of his shoulders that he had lost hope. He had a defeated look, and I couldn't blame him. My words and actions must have seemed crazy to him. They even did to me. When the bedside phone rang at 7 o'clock in the morning, I reached for it with half-closed eyes, expecting the usual calving or milk fever. But it was Lionel.
"I'm just off to me work, Miss Herriot, but I thought thou'd like to know about them pigs first."
I snapped, wide awake.
"Yes, I would. How are they?"
"They're all right."
"How do you mean, all right? Are they all alive?"
"Aye, every one."
"Are they ill in any way?"
"Nay, nay, every one of them shouting for their breakfast just like they were yesterday morning."
I fell back on the pillow, still grasping the phone, and my sigh of relief must have been audible at the other end because Lionel chuckled.
"Aye, that's how I feel too, Miss Herriot. By God, it's a miracle. I thought you'd go around the bend yesterday with all that salt talk, but you were right, lad. Talk about saving my bacon. You really did it, didn't you?"
I laughed.
"I suppose I did, in more ways than one."
Over my 40 years in practice, I have seen only half a dozen cases of salt poisoning or water deprivation or whatever you like to call it. I don't suppose it is all that common. But the one at Lionel stays in my mind as the most exciting and the happiest. I thought this unexpected triumph would settle the roadman down for good as a pig keeper. But I was wrong again. It was several weeks before I was on his place, and just as I was leaving, a young man rode up on a bicycle. Lionel introduced him.
"This is Billy Fothergill, Mr. Herriot."
I shook hands with a smiling lad of about 22.
"Billy's taken over my place next month."
"What?"
"It's right. I've sold him the pigs and he's going to rent the buildings from me. In fact, he's doing all work now."
"Well, I'm surprised, Lionel," I said. "I thought you were doing what you wanted to do." He looked at me quizzically.
"So did I for a bit. But I'll tell you, that salt jaw really gave me a shock. I thought I was ruined, and that's a nasty feeling at my time of life. Billy's been pigman for Sir Thomas Rowe for 3 years, and he's just got married. Feels like branching out for himself-like."
I looked at the young man. He wasn't tall, but the bullet head, muscular shoulders, and slightly bowed legs gave the impression of a great power. He looked as though he could run through a brick wall.
"I know it's for best," Lionel went on. "That piggery was all right, but it was Alice just a bit on top of me. Sort of a worry-like. I reckon Billy'll manage the job better than me."
I looked again at Billy's stubby features, at the brown skin, the unclouded eyes, and the confident grin.
"Oh, yes," I said. "He'll manage all right."
As the roadman walked back towards my car with me, I tapped his elbow. "But, Lionel, aren't you going to miss your livestock? It was your great hobby, wasn't it?"
"By God, you're right. It was, and it still is. I couldn't do without some stock to look after. I've filled up Tower Hut again. Come and have a look."
We walked over to the hut and opened the door. And it was like turning back the clock. A cow, 3 calves, 2 goats, 2 pigs, and some assorted poultry all sectioned off with outlandish partitions. I could see the bed frames and wire netting with loops of binder twine hanging from every corner. The only difference was that he had moved the dining table to a position immediately inside the door, and a grand piano lid stood proudly by the side of the cow. He pointed out the various animals and gave me a brief history of each, and as he spoke there was a contentment in his face which had been absent for some time. "Only 2 pigs, eh, Lionel?" I said. He nodded slowly.
"Aye, that's enough."
I left him there and went over to the car. And as I opened the door, I looked back across the field. From this angle, I could shut out the garish new piggery, so that I saw only the stone cottage with its sheltering trees and the old hut nearby. The roadman was leaning against the upended dining table, and as he gazed at his mixed charges, the smoke from his pipe rose high against the backcloth of the hills. The whole picture looked just right, and I smiled to myself. That was Lionel's kind of farming. Chapter 38. It was a Sunday morning in June, and I was washing my hands in the sink in Matt Clark's kitchen. The sun was bright, with a brisk wind scouring the fell sides, so that through the window I could see every cleft and gully lying sharp and clear on the green flanks,
as the cloud shadows drove across them. I glanced back beyond the stone flags at the white head of Grandma Clark, bent over her knitting. The radio on the dresser was tuned to the morning service, and as I watched, the old lady looked up from her work and listened intently to some words of the sermon for a few moments before starting her needles clicking again. In that brief time, I had a profound impression of serenity and unquestioning faith, which has remained with me to this day. It's a strange thing, but over the years, whenever I have heard discussions and arguments on religion, on the varying beliefs and doctrines, on the sincerity or otherwise of some pious individuals, there still rises before me the seamed old face and calm eyes of Grandma Clark. She knew and was secure. Goodness seemed to flow from her. She was in her late 80s and always dressed in black with a little black neckband. She had come through the hard times of farming and could look back on a long life of toil in the fields as well as in the home. As I reached for the towel, the farmer led Rosie into the kitchen. "Mr. Clark's been showing me some baby chicks, Daddy," she said. Grandma looked up again. "Is that your little lass, Mr. Herriot?" "Yes, Mrs. Clark," I replied. "This is Rosie."
"Aye, of course. I've seen her before, many a time."
The old lady put down her knitting and rose stiffly from her chair. She shuffled over to a cupboard, brought out a gaily coloured tin, and extracted a bar of chocolate.
"How old are you now, Rosie?"
she asked as she presented the chocolate.
"Thank you. I'm 6,
my daughter replied. Grandma looked down at the smiling face, at the sturdy tanned legs in their blue shorts and sandals.
"Well, you're a grand little lass."
For a moment she rested her work-roughened hand against the little girl's cheek, then she returned to her chair. They didn't make much of a fuss, those old Yorkshire folk, but to me the gesture was like a benediction. The old lady picked up her knitting again.
"And how's that lad of yours? How's Jimmy?"
"Oh, he's fine, thank you. 10 years old now. He's out with some of his pals this morning."
10, eh? 10 and 6. 10 and 6.
For a few seconds, her thoughts seemed far away as she plied her needles. Then she looked at me again.
"Maybe you don't know it, Mr. Herriot, but this is the best time of your life."
"Do you think so?"
"Aye, there's no doubt about it. When your children are young and growing up around you, that's when it's best. It's the same for everybody, only a lot of folk don't know it, and a lot find out when it's too late. It doesn't last long, you know."
"I believe I've always realised that, Mrs. Clark, without thinking about it very much."
"Reckon you have, young man."
She gave me a sideways smile. "You allus seem to have one or t'other of your bairns with you on your calls." As I drove away from the farm, the old lady's words stayed in my mind. They are still in my mind all these years later, when Helen and I are soon to celebrate our ruby wedding of 40 years of marriage. Life has been good to us, and is still good to us. We are lucky. We have had so many good times. But I think we both agree that Grandma Clark was right about the very best time of all. When I got back to Scaledale House that summer morning, I found Siegfried replenishing the store of drugs in his car boot. His children, Alan and Janet, were helping him. Like me, he usually took his family around with him. He banged down the lid of the boot.
"Right, that's that for another few days."
He glanced at me and smiled.
"There are no more calls at the moment, James. Let's have a walk down the back."
With the children running ahead of us, we went through the passage and out into the long garden behind the house. Here the sunshine was imprisoned between the high old walls, with the wind banished to the upper air and ruffling the top leaves of the apple trees. When we reached the big lawn, Siegfried flopped on the turf and rested on his elbow. I sat down by his side. My partner pulled a piece of grass and chewed it, contemplatively. "Pity about the acacia," he murmured. I looked at him in surprise. It was many years since the beautiful tree which had once soared from the middle of the garden had blown down in a gale. "Yes, it is," I said. "It was magnificent.
I paused for a moment. Remember, I fell asleep against it the first day I came here to apply for a job. We first met right on this spot. Siegfried laughed. I do remember. He looked around him at the mellow brick and stone copings of the walls, at the rockery and rosebed, the children playing in the old henhouse at the far end. My word, James. When you think about it, we've come through a few things together since then. A lot of water, as they say, has flowed under the bridge. We were both silent for a while, and my thoughts went back over the struggles and the laughter of those years. Almost unconsciously, I lay back on the grass and closed my eyes, feeling the sun warm on my face, hearing the hum of the bees among the flowers, the croaking of the rooks and the great elms which overhung the yard. My colleague's voice seemed to come from afar. Hey, you're not going to do the same trick again, are you? Going to sleep in front of me? I sat up, blinking. Gosh, I'm sorry, Siegfried. I nearly did. I was out at a farrowing at 5 o'clock this morning, and it's just catching up with me. Ah, well, he said, smiling. You won't need your book tonight. I laughed. No, I won't. Not tonight. Neither Siegfried nor I suffered from insomnia, but on the rare occasions when sleep would not come, we had recourse to our particular books. Mine was The Brothers Karamazov, a great novel, but to me, soporific in its names. Even at the beginning, I felt those names lulling me. Alexei Fedorovich Karamazov was the third son of Fyodor Pavlovich Karamazov. Then, by the time I had encountered Grigory Kutuzov, Yefim Petrovich Polonov, Stepanida Bedryagina, and a few others, I was floating away. With Siegfried, it was a book on the physiology of the eye which he kept by his bedside. There was one passage which never failed to start him nodding. He showed it to me once. The first ciliary muscle is inserted into the ciliary body, and by its contraction pulls the ciliary body forward and so slackens the tension on the suspensory ligament, while the second ciliary muscle is a circular muscle embedded in the ciliary body and by its contraction drags the ciliary body towards the crystalline lens. He had never managed to get much further than that. No, I said, rubbing my eyes, I won't need any encouragement tonight. I rolled onto my side. By the way, I was at Matt Clark's this morning. I told him what Grandma had said. Siegfried selected a fresh piece of grass and resumed his chewing. Well, she's a wise old lady, and she's seen it all. If she's right, we'll have no regrets in the future, because we have both enjoyed our children, and been with them from the beginning. I was beginning to feel sleepy again when my partner startled me by sitting up abruptly. Do you know, James, he said, I'm convinced that the same thing applies to our job. We're going through the best time there, too. Do you think so? Sure of it. Look at all the new advances since the war. Drugs and procedures we never dreamt of. We can look after our animals in a way that would have been impossible a few years ago, and the farmers realize this. You've seen them crowding into the surgery on market days to ask advice. They've gained a new respect for the profession. And they know it pays to call in the vet now. That's true, I said. We're certainly busier than we've ever been, with the ministry work going full blast too. Yes. Everything is buzzing. In fact, James, I'd like to bet that these present years are the high noon of country practice. I thought for a moment. You could be right. But if we are on the top now, does it mean that our lives will decline later? No, no, of course not. They'll be different, that's all. I sometimes think we've only touched the fringe of so many other things, like small animal work. Siegfried brandished his gnawed piece of grass at me, and his eyes shone with the enthusiasm which always uplifted me. I tell you this, James, there are great days ahead.
We hope you've enjoyed The Lord God Made Them All. Text copyright 1986 by James Herriot. Production copyright 2005 by Audio Renaissance, a division of Holtzbrinck Publishers, LLC. All rights reserved. Rights reserved. Rights reserved.
Thank you for listening to our audiobooks. We do our best to regularly upload quality books with clear narrations. Please subscribe to our channel and click the notification bell icon so we can bring you more great books. Thank you very much, and we hope you enjoyed listening to your audiobook.